Everyone, and a very happy new year. All right, today we are going to discuss about mind. Some part of it some of you may have already been familiar with. We've discussed it earlier. However, we'll be taking a step ahead and we would be discussing a little more about it. So, we would be touching upon a little bit on dreams, how conscious and unconscious mind kind of interact with one another and how we work with it, and at the same time certain techniques, certain processes which can create some sort of a change will be discussed. Alright, so at the end we'll be discussing some self-help methods which everyone can take away with them and maybe apply if required. Okay, so there are different schools of thought. Some schools of thought will say there is conscious, subconscious and unconscious, and then there are schools of thought which will say it's conscious and unconscious, and we use the words interchangeably as subconscious or unconscious. However, the overall understanding of the model would more or less remain the same. We just have different terminologies and different explanations for different parts of the mind. Okay, so subconscious is used majorly by UK and unconscious is used a lot by US. Alright, the functions will not differ, you go to any theory. In this model, we won't be discussing anything to do with superconscious. Alright, so can we proceed further? Any questions before that about mind or any particular objective with which you want to understand certain things? None? So I'll proceed further. My introduction, my name is Paulomi and I'm a psychologist. I'm also a trainer and I also am interested in maternal health, so I practice hypnobirthing. I've been trained extensively in clinical hypnosis and neuro-linguistic programming, known as NLP. So whatever we'd be discussing would be an amalgamation of all of this, and I'll try to make it as practical as possible and as easy to understand as possible without using too much of technical jargons. Okay? Alright. So, this some of you may have already seen and known. Our mind, you can say, is something which is different from our brain. If I use the computer analogy, brain will become the hardware and mind becomes the software. So, brain is something beneath our skull. It has a physical form. Mind, you can't really say that it has a physical form or it can be touched or felt. It's not an organ. Alright, there are different parts of the mind. There is conscious and then there is the subconscious, and there are further divisions in it. Let's first talk about the conscious mind. Conscious mind comprises of 10 to 12% of the total. It is responsible for thinking, logic, feeling, analysis, decision making and voluntary body movements. Voluntary body movements? What you want to do, I will pick this up, this is voluntary body movement. Subconscious mind or the unconscious mind, I purposely use it interchangeably, comprises of the remaining 88 to 90%. Alright, it is uniform across everybody. There are no different percentages across different human beings or races. At the same time, you can say subconscious mind or the unconscious mind is responsible for the storage of all the experiences we have had right from the time we were conceived till today. Alright, so even when we were conceived and we were small cells, whatever was happening in the environment was being absorbed by us. It stores in all this information, including you can say the color of the shirt that my father was wearing when I was born. Do we remember it today? No, not really. We wouldn't, right? And that is because we can only recall or remember information if it has been repeated. Okay? So we need to repeat information, or it needs to have a strong association or a link for us to recall it easily. Right? So if I was to tell you that, okay, can you tell me this particular theorem from your math book? it'll be like, what kind of theorem? And you may not really, you know, recall it. If I say Pythagorean theorem, you may still not be able to recall it unless you are in touch with the subject. Either you belong to that field extensively or you have somebody who's reminded you of that. Let's say a child or a grandchild you're learning or teaching. So that way you are somewhere in touch with it. That's because of the repetition. Association would be a strong link between the two. Alright? So one will remind you of the other. Okay? For now, I'm going to stop here with this particular part of association. We'll discuss this as we proceed further. Okay? So subconscious mind is a storehouse of all our experiences, and it is also responsible for our involuntary body movement. Involuntary body movements would be?
Breathing,
digestion, heart rate, blinking. All these things are involuntary body movements. Alright? It's governed by the subconscious or the unconscious mind. Now, it can be further divided into parts, wherein you can say the subconscious mind will be divided into modern memory and primitive mind. Modern memory is what we are talking about currently, wherein all the memories and from the time we were conceived, so on and so forth, over here. Primitive mind, on the other hand, will have certain instincts and certain inborn fears that we are all born with. Alright, so the ones who believe in past life state that certain experiences of past life are also stored in the primitive mind and that these instincts come from there. Some theories will say that it comes from the genetic coding. However, the instincts and fear have been found in very proven instincts. Okay, two instincts that we are born with, survival instincts, fight and flight. Any idea what is fight and flight? Do it or run? Okay. And so fight would be, you know, people say fighting, and flight would be running away. Now, it need not be so physical in nature because our survival is not so physical in nature anymore. So fight and flight would mean simply that fight is to stay in the situation and resolve the crisis. And flight will be to move away from the situation to resolve the crisis. At the end of the day, both the factors, fight and flight, are actually helping us resolve crisis, either by staying in it or moving away from it. Alright? Also, we as human beings got more creative and we have a third response. Some people call it freeze, or you can say playing dead. Playing dead basically means there is a crisis. You feel discomfort as a result of the crisis, but you choose to do nothing about it. Alright? So for example, if let's say my boss is shouting at me and humiliates me very, you know, frequently on and off, fight would be I go approach my boss and tell my boss that I don't like how you speak to me. This is not done. That is fight. I'm trying to resolve the problem by being in it. Flight would be I may resign and say I don't want to be a part of this place. Now it so happens that I realize I can't fight the boss, nor can I leave the job, it's got perks. So I then decide to play dead. I feel that crisis, I feel the emotional turmoil or that anger or whatever it is because of whatever the boss is doing to me. But I choose to do nothing because it's not going to be fruitful for me, for whatever reasons. That is playing dead. Now, long-term playing dead would result in today's modern-day phenomena is called depression. People keep playing dead in jobs, people keep playing dead in relationships and various other areas. Alright? So, playing dead ultimately would lead to some problem, but it is again useful for a short period of time. Can you tell me how? Since it's not in your hands? No, playing dead is very much in our hands. Okay. So basically playing dead is a good strategy to buy time. If I want to buy time to either fight or fly, playing dead is perfect. Alright? I'm buying time. But for how long is the question. So to give you a healthy example of playing dead, let's say I, you know, have a huge fight and let's say my boss insulted me in front of everybody and I realize that, you know, this is happening very frequently and this shouldn't happen. Alright? Now, if I fight or fly to do anything, whether I go resign or whether I go and tell my boss this is not done, this doesn't seem to work. So I wait for 2-3 days till I figure that maybe now my boss will be doing this better. And then I go and approach the boss. So at that point of time, playing dead makes complete sense. But if I keep stretching it in the long run, it's only going to turn out to be harmful for me. Alright? Okay. And the other two fears that we have got, fear of falling and fear of
loud noises.
These are the two fears we have got. Okay. Now, people say that, okay, fear of death, that's also a fear. But remember, think of these fears from the point of view of a child. Alright, you look at an infant, the infant doesn't know what is death. Infant doesn't know what is darkness. They don't know other things, but loud noises, we would still get startled, like a boom, a loud noise, and we'd be like, oh my god, what just happened? Or falling. You see, very young babies, alright, you keep them at the edge, you'll notice how they try to balance themselves out. Don't try, but yeah, under supervision. Alright? So, fear of falling and fear of loud noises are something we are born with. Other fears that we get are acquired fears, or you can say learned fears. We learn to feel scared of darkness. We learn to feel scared of, let's say, lizards, dogs, and other things. Alright? And it could be a simple experience which you remember that after this I feel scared, or after this I feel the fear, or it could just be a very random association that has happened which you may not be aware of. Sometimes, you know, elder siblings can be really funny, being one of them. So it's like, light chale gai, woh kar diya chote bache ko jaake, and the child gets scared. Darkness and fear associated. Okay? Small things like, for example, let's say my father is scared of dogs. Now my father is like my superhero, comes to drop me to school and he's this and he's that, and he runs seeing a dog. Dog must be harmful. Right? So, like that, we pick up fears. We learn these fears. In fact, there was a research done on fears which stated that the number of people who are scared of public speaking is far greater than the number of people who are scared of death. So, by far, fear of public speaking is the largest acquired fear. Whatever is acquired can be unacquired. Alright? So, these are the two fears, falling, loud noises, two instincts that we spoke of. Again, past life, if you believe in it, please believe in it. It's completely up to you. Don't want to believe in it, don't want to believe in it. Perfectly fine. We leave it open. Okay. Conscious, subconscious or unconscious, and it can be divided into two parts, modern memory and primitive mind. Okay. Let's now focus on the association part of it. Alright. What do we understand by association? With another? Sure. So going, yeah. In a way we try to organize, okay. So what is happening over here is, associations are formed obviously as a result of experiences that we've had. We link things. So let's say somebody was to come and tell me that, oh, you remember this girl from our class, her name was Pooja, and she's doing really well, yeah. I'd be like, who Pooja? She's like, hurry, that same girl. Be like, there are so many girls with a name like that. I don't know which one you're talking about. And then my friend says, you know, that Pooja, because of whom in that class you were kicked out because she had put something on your bench, and remember your parents were called to school and all that. Be like, oh my god, that one. Suddenly everything related to that episode and that girl would come flooding in, that, oh, this happened, that happened. How? Because that one episode became a trigger for me. I didn't remember her, but I remembered her as a result of me remembering that I was kicked out. Unless I was kicked out like multiple times, but because I was kicked out. Alright, so it became a strong link between the two. So one thing will make you recall the other. Many a times it can be very much on the surface. Like for example, this one was very much on surface. Like I'll be like, oh, that girl I know. I remembered it very clearly. However, many a times these triggers that we are talking about can be very, very subtle and very, very unconscious in nature. You may not know where this is coming from. So simple things like sometimes you've just met the person for the first time and just looking at that person, you feel some irritation. That person may have not done anything to you, but you still feel that irritation. Pata nahi isko dekh ke ajeeb lagta hai, you know, something of that sort. Maybe, again hypothetical, maybe that person reminds you of someone you don't really like. Okay? And somewhere your mind is joined that, oh, this one looks like that one, or this one's, the mannerisms are similar. Oh, the same pain triggered. Oh, I see the person. Not like it. Okay, very unknown to us. Certain people's voices. They can be like, oh, I just hear this one's voice and I feel so good. That person may have not done anything to you right now. Why are you feeling good? There's something which makes us feel good. There is some sort of a link or some sort of an association. Okay? That was stored in the modern memory. But to recall it or let's say to bring it to the conscious brain, one needs to have a constant, you need to be in touch with it, that is constant repetition, or you need to have a strong link like we just spoke about. Okay? Any questions so far? Fear of public speaking could have many, many reasons for different people. It could be some sort of an experience where they've had. It could simply be, let's say, they were not prepared for it. Or it could simply be that they may feel a little intimidated seeing others. It could have multiple reasons, but there will be no specific cause. So like in physiological symptoms, we will have specific causes. You know, a list of 9-10 things, out of which one of this will fall in place. When it comes to anything related to the mind, out of those 9-10 things, we may think these are the required elements, but it may also have an added element. Okay, and we cannot have a specific one to each person. So let's say this is a room full of people, for example, scared of lizards. Just an example. Okay, everyone will have a different approach for it. Some people may jump seeing the lizard, some people may run away, some people may just cringe. The root cause of it could be something completely different, and many a times there is no experience also. It's just a funny story that our mind may create for us. Alright, so for everybody it's going to be a very subjective experience, and even the treatment part will be very subjective. There would be nothing specific. Yeah? Now, mind receives information from different sources. The environment, alright? I see, hear, feel things from the environment, whatever is going on around me. The body, I'll get certain messages that this posture is comfortable, this is not comfortable. I'm having some sensations, or my head is hurting, or any of that. Getting messages from the body. Conscious mind and the subconscious or the unconscious mind. So, when I say conscious mind, what is happening is, I am right now, let's say, listening to someone. From whatever I'm listening, I'm trying to make some analysis that, oh, this is what is different, or this is what is the same, and this is what matches and this doesn't. This analysis that is going on currently is coming from the conscious mind, giving the information to itself. And the subconscious mind is where previous experiences you're thinking of. So it's like, oh, she's talking like this about mine, somebody else said this, or somebody else said something different. And we are trying to bring that information onto surface. So, environment, conscious mind, subconscious mind, as well as the body. Which now brings us to the development of something called as the critical filter. And it's very critical in terms of understanding the mind. So what happens is, when we are young, okay, the information that we get is very, very simple and it's very basic, okay, easy, simple, small information. As we grow older, the information starts to become more repetitive in nature and a little bit complex, you know, you get more in bundles. Conscious mind has a limited capacity to process information. Okay, it's like, have you seen those Sanjay Leela Bhansali movies? Yeah, have we seen that? Huge crowd behind, okay? So many people are dancing and there are so many people behind. Dozens of dancers, hundreds of them. You can't notice each and every one of them, can you? For all you know, somebody standing in the third or the fourth line may be doing this to you. You wouldn't know. Right? So it's going to be very difficult for us to go. So we have a limited capacity that way. So when the information kept coming in, the conscious mind will have to process the information. The quality of the subconscious mind is very simple. It will take information as it is without any analysis. So take your subconscious or the unconscious mind as a child. It will only take in information as it is without any analysis and store it. Now beyond a point, the conscious mind cannot process more information, so it needed help. Therefore, this filter was created. This filter acts like a gatekeeper. Alright? It is formed between the ages of 0 and 8. It's very unique to each of us. It contains our beliefs and certain patterns that we have developed. Alright? And it is going to contain the repetitive information. So for example, let's say as a child, I made a mistake. Okay? And let's say my father comes and tells me that you're stupid. For example. Now, my little conscious mind will try to analyze, when I do this, I'm stupid. This happens again and again and again. Eventually, what happens is that conscious mind realizes that, okay, you know what, whenever you're doing this kind of a thing, you actually... So every time I don't have this energy and time to analyze this information, you already know. Let's put it in the filter. So now, what happens is a similar takes place. I'm stupid is what plays on my mind very unknowingly in most cases, and I function based on that. Okay, so for example, if it's to do with some sort of work, if I believe I am stupid, and while coming for some interaction like this, okay, somebody comes and tells me you're stupid, this is going to go for a toss. It's in sync with my filter. It would immediately get absorbed and it will be acted upon. But if I believe that I am good enough and somebody comes and says the same thing, you're stupid, you know, your talk is going to go for a toss, and be like, mind your own business, I'll see what I have to do. Right? Why so? Why? It's not a part of my filter, right? Will it be fair to say that we must only and only have positive beliefs? Not possible. And if let's say it was possible, is it a good idea? Need a mixture of both. And in fact, when we say positive, we forget to attach realistic to it. Alright, so many a times, many parents who believe in positive parenting, they bombard their child with positive inputs. You're great, you're a genius, you're this, you're that. Super. You're a winner, you will always succeed. The child is in fourth grade, goes for a race, loses the race. Belief system shattered. What do you do? Right. So what is important is that we have a positive approach, but a realistic one too. Some of the negative ones we won't be able to control. Even twins having the same environment will not have the exact same belief system, and we cannot really control what the mind absorbs and how the child perceives it. Alright? So as parents maybe, parents can try their best, but ultimately, whenever you do something positive, please add the pinch of realistic factor. So basically our filter acts like a mold. Take an example of a watchman of a company. Okay, if there were 3-4 people working in the company, the watchman will remember the faces and even the names of those 3-4 people who are coming and going out. As the company grows, there will be hundreds of people joining in. Is it possible to remember hundreds of them? It's not. Therefore, companies will have their ID cards. Only those people with those ID cards will be able to swipe in and enter. If there is a new person, the watchman will then check and get all the information, make a temporary pass for that person and then let the person in. But what happens over here? If the watchman says that, acha, this one is not supposed to be going, interview ke liye inko nahi bula, the person is let out. So what is this filter doing? The filter is like a watchman over here. Only lets you in if that thing is in sync. The pass is available to you. Okay? So conscious mind, filter, and the subconscious or the unconscious mind. Remember, it's developed between 0 to 0 and 8 years, which is why you say ki bachche ke saath achhe achhe baatein karo, say good things, positive stories and all of that, because you are somewhere developing the child's filter. At the same time, certain beliefs, certain ideas will change as we grow up. Alright? So young children may believe in tooth fairies, Santa Claus, coming and giving gifts in the night. Eventually as they grow up, that changes. Right? So some with experiences, certain factors and beliefs would change. Many of them we may not be even aware of. Some of them we only become aware of when they become a hindrance for us over a period of time. Alright? Whether you can change the beliefs or not, the answer is yes. And there are different ways in which you can go ahead and do that. Filtering is done by the filter. So conscious mind receives the information, sends it to the filter. Alright? Filter will filter the information. If it's a very new information, the conscious mind will first analyze it. Alright? Now if the filter thinks it's the proper information, like the gate pass that I mentioned, then it will go in for storage to the subconscious. If the conscious mind analyzes the information and sees that it is relevant information, then theek hai, it will go in again for storage. Filter sends it to the subconscious. So conscious mind first, then the filter, then the subconscious.
That conscious mind analyzes the information, then allows to go to subconscious.
Conscious mind will get the information, okay? It will then send it to the filter first. From the filter, based on the filter, it will then go to the subconscious. Okay, so conscious mind will not, so it's going through the conscious mind, but conscious mind will have filter in between. Then it will go through the subconscious, so subconscious becomes like a gate through which it goes.
Analyzing
part will be from the conscious mind. That will be done by the conscious mind, if it's new information, that is. Any old or repetitive information will directly go to the filter. Any new information that a person gets will be analyzed by the conscious mind. It's half in conscious, half in subconscious. Alright? So you can see this clearly. Now based on that, the information gets stored either as pleasure or as pain. So let's say I have teachers in school. Okay? A happy teacher and a sad teacher. And this happy teacher is somebody who always smiles, says good morning, pats my back, asks me how's my day and so on. Alright. Now, my mind has stored her as, let's say, pleasure. Feels good meeting her, she's very sweet, very nice, etc. Now, there is another teacher who always frowns seeing me. She'll always scold me for something or the other. So, my mind has stored her as pain. Correct? Now what happens, one day this happy teacher or this teacher which gives me happiness, she comes and she's in a bad mood. And I tell her good morning, she doesn't even respond. Now I go to her and I'll say, teacher, you didn't even say good morning, what happened? And she'll say, oh, it's not you, I'm just having a bad day. Anyway, take care, have a good day. And she again pats my back and she's in a good mood. Now what happens? I'll say, yeah, she's happy teacher, she's good. On the other hand, the other teacher, who was not always very good to me, she is in a good mood today. She says, oh, good morning, how was your day? And I'll say, what happened, ma'am? You need something from me? And she said, this is why I keep scolding you for things. You just don't apply your mind and you say anything. Now, for me, see, I knew it. She always scolds and she'll always pick on me. So pleasure remains pleasure, pain remains pain. Why? Because this is how I'm segregating my information. It becomes something what we call as the self-fulfilling prophecy. We ensure that our beliefs remain the same. We work towards it very unknowingly. Alright? So from conscious, the information, so conscious holds the information for 1 to 1.5 hours. Alright? Then it goes to the critical conscious. Basically, now we are talking about the filter. Critical conscious will hold on to the information for 24 hours or till we relax or till we sleep. It will then go on for segregation, which will then go in for storage, and it may get stored as pleasure or pain. So information goes in this way, it also comes out like that. Because I've stored it as pleasure or pain, so I'm working towards it in a particular manner to sustain it. And my behavior as a result of it is affected. So there is an event which takes place. Which then triggers certain beliefs or certain ideas that I have. Alright? Based on these triggers, these ideas, I will create a different world of mine, a different idea of the whole thing. Which then will make me feel certain feelings, which then will affect my behavior. And therefore, it will result into some outcome depending on what my belief is. Alright? So, filter becomes very, very important. Okay? Clear about this? Now, subconscious is also responsible for certain dreams. Not certain dreams, for dreams, for all sorts of dreams. Any idea about dreams? What is going on in sleep? Sure. So dreams basically, alright, we see dreams when we are sleeping. Now daydreaming is different, you're in your own thoughts. Dreaming while you are sleeping is different. People say, humko sapne nahi aate, that's not true. We do see dreams, we do get dreams, we may not remember. Alright? Dreams can be divided into three parts. So let's say you sleep for 9 hours, then 3 hours, 6 hours, then 2 hours. Ideally, don't sleep for less than 6 hours. Okay? The first part of the dream is called a processing dream. Processing dream will be about whatever has happened through the day. The mind is sort of processing all that information. Second part is the predictive phase. Predictive phase is wherein your mind knows whatever has happened through the day, whatever is going on currently. It also knows what has been happening since couple of years. Right? So let's say a year ago I was put on a project. I have been working for the project since a year, and today my boss yells at me and says, you know, you've done a bad job, you've wasted money, you've wasted time, it's been a year, blah, 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 blah. Now my mind has information for what's happened today and 1 year, of that project. Clubbing it together, it will show me a dream which, in which maybe I am kicked out of my job. So it's predicting that the way in which you have been working since a year, and considering whatever has happened today, there are high chances of this taking place. That is prediction, predictive dreams. It sort of gives you the future based on whatever information you have. Then comes the third phase, which is the venting phase. Venting means throwing out, removing completely. Okay? In the sense, let's say I am thinking of promotion, taking the same example, but my boss has shouted at me today and for 1 year I have not done a good job. So my mind will show me an idea of promotion. Looks positive, but actually it's telling me that you are going to be kicked out, so throw the idea of promotion is being thrown out. So venting dreams are actually the opposite of what is going on or what is likely to happen. Okay, did we understand the difference between the two, predictive and venting? Yeah, so venting is the opposite. Now people say that acha teen phases hai, second phase ye hai, third phase ye hai, but there is no hard and fast rule to figure which phase it is. You may see a dream, you can't wake up, note the time, 3 more hours, go back to sleep and then predict. That's not possible. Alright? So, the order of it is very tricky to figure. Ideally, one does not fidget with dreams till they are very recurrent in nature. Alright? If it's just one dream that you may have seen, you may have just experienced, it's okay. It's a dream, no problem. If you get a recurrent dream and it's causing trouble, then maybe some help will be required. Or if somebody is already taking some sort of professional help and witnesses a dream or goes through some experience like that, you can then inform your practitioner about it. Alright? So we cannot take this as it is. At the same time, there are certain key factors about dreams. Alright? Let me just talk about dreams first. So dreams are metaphoric. They are metaphorical in nature. That is, right now how we are looking at each other, if we see a dream, we may not see exact faces like that. So if the boss shouts at me, I may not witness the boss shouting at me as it is. It may be like a dragon spitting fire, where dragon becomes the representation of boss. So dreams are symbolic, you can say. Something else. It may need not be exactly how it is. At the same time, the best interpretation of dreams come from somebody who has experienced it rather than you interpreting it for someone. There are many dream keys and dream books and everything which tell you different things. But a person will be the best one to tell you about what he or she thinks of that dream to be. Alright? And it's not a good idea to generalize explanations of dreams to all sorts of dreams of people. Okay, so if somebody sees the same kind of dream, it's not a very good idea to generalize the same understanding. It's better that the person himself or herself interprets the dream. Again, only interpret dreams if you think it is important. If you think it is recurring and it is causing some trouble. Alright? If you want to stop seeing dreams, simplest thing is your mind is very obedient. Before sleeping, just tell your mind, I wish to stop seeing dreams. Do it for some days, your mind will actually listen to you. You want to understand the meaning of a dream better? Do this with your mind again, that I would like to understand the meaning of this. So please explain it to me in a simplistic manner before you go off to sleep. You'll get it in some days. So don't glorify dream work too much, because people like doing that. Okay. On the previous one, so when we spoke about this, taking the computer analogy, the CPU will be the conscious mind and the hard disk or the storage will be the subconscious mind. Alright, because it's storing all the information that we have. Okay. How mind works, we briefly discussed that. We're just going to touch upon it again. So, we already spoke about, just a second, we already spoke about conscious, subconscious and the filters. Beliefs, you can say, are more permanent rules or stronger rules that our mind has, that this is what is good for me or this is what I have to do. conscious mind creates rules first, and many a times they are very temporary in nature. Let's say I want to become very fit. This is my new rule. From now on, I'll really, really focus on healthy eating habits and exercise really well. I've decided. But my experience, which is stored in the subconscious mind or the unconscious, what does it say? Sleeping till late is amazing. Having sweets, fried food is so good, you know, it's delicious. So what is happening as a result of it? There is a conflict, there is a clash. Because somebody says, oh, take this, this is a plate of gulab jamun, and it's like the best gulab jamun you'll ever have. Fitness, na, nahi, nahi, I will not eat. After some time, I'll be very tempted to take it. Why? Because I have experienced the taste of gulab jamun or that dessert. I really love it. And then I will break my rule. Why do I want to be fit? I want to be fit because, you know, I'll be healthy. And why do I want to be healthy? If I want to be healthy, I'll feel really happy and good. So by eating gulab jamun, I'll feel happy and good only, na? So I'll eat it. So immediately the temporary rule goes for a toss. Alright? So basically our rules and experiences are two wheels of the same bicycle. Till they are in sync and in balance, life is good. For rules, temporary rules to become more permanent rules, they need to become a part of the filter. Alright, and that comes with constant practice. Clear till here? So I have a question for all of you. More powerful, according to you. What about the filter? So let's understand this with the help of an example. Let's see how. So, let's say I decide to smoke. Okay. I pick up a cigarette, I start smoking. Now, when people smoke for the first time, they experience this discomfort, they start coughing, right? It's coming from the subconscious. Automatic, right? But still I choose to smoke. I will still smoke. I want to try. I want to finish the cigarette. So there my conscious becomes powerful than the unconscious in spite of getting the discomfort and the signals. Eventually I successfully start smoking. I can smoke comfortably. It's all good. For anything I smoke, lunch ke baad smoke, break me smoke, everything. Now I realize that, you know, I've been smoking a bit too much. I've been finishing packets, let's say. I should quit smoking, you know, enough. So now I decide to quit smoking. Temporary rule. It's so ingrained that when I'm stressed, I want to smoke. After lunch, I want to smoke. To belong to the group, I want to smoke. Because it's become a part of my filter, it's ingrained. So now the filter becomes stronger than the conscious mind. Correct? I've decided, still I'm not able to do it. Eventually, it so happens that I need to maybe seek some sort of help. Or, I may be meditating over it or doing some sort of processes. And then, to change the filter and the links and the beliefs in the filter, I take help of the unconscious mind. Ultimately, all of them are powerful than the other in different areas. They work as a team brilliantly. In stages, sure. In stages would be a better word. At different stages.
If the conscious mind filters some negative things into the subconscious, then it is destructible to the man's progress.
Yes, that's true. If there are things which are not in, because subconscious will not absorb information.
So, filtration is not always, suppose it depends on the conscious mind.
You cannot say it depends on the conscious mind only. The filter will play a role by default.
But how that negative thoughts are...
Because again, they are in sync with the filter. So, for example, right. So, subconscious mind will not analyze information. We understand that, right? Critical filter, for example, let's say conscious mind, on my conscious mind, the thoughts are that this person is irritating me, harassing me, troubling me, etc., etc. Okay, these are not happy thoughts. Now, I want to do something about it. Before I process this whole information and I act upon it, a whole process goes in which will depend on my belief system. So, if I store all this information that, yeah, you know, people of this category are bad, they always do this, and I, you know, this thing continues. Now, my actions will be dependent on what my belief is. If I believe that killing or stabbing somebody with a knife is good, it's in my filter that it's good, then I will go ahead and do it. But if I believe that no matter what, you know, however this person reacts and all, I feel very angry, agitated, and I feel so annoyed by it, but I will not go and hit the person or physically harm the person, I may just stay away. So that decision will depend on the filter. But yes, the information, whatever is happening in the environment, would go in. But how we act to it will be completely dependent on the filter. So negative thoughts are something obviously will occur if there is any instance that is taking place.
How would the mind control the negative thoughts?
Okay, so negative thoughts on and off are very natural.
They are being filtered by the conscious mind.
Again, so negative thoughts we get almost every day, and it's a daily part and parcel of our life. It's only a problem if it's causing a lot of hindrance and they are very recurrent about the same thing. So it's only when we have a particular situation or a problem or a difficulty will we have the same kind of negative thoughts again and again. In that case, we need to work with the core issue and resolve the whole problem itself for us to be able to help upon with the negative thoughts. So negative thoughts are part and parcel. I mean, every day we get at least one negative thought. It's very natural. Yeah?
Conscious mind don't have positive thinking.
You're saying doesn't have it at all, is what you're saying? That's actually very difficult unless there is a huge disorder that the person has. But that's very difficult. Again, the way we get at least one negative thought in the day, we will also have at least one positive thought in the day. Okay. How do we create a shift in our mind? We can talk to someone. Alright? It's a good idea to have a friend, somebody very close, a confidant you can go to, speak to, which will help us with maybe some insights, some awareness, or maybe just introspection can lead to some sort of an insight or awareness about the difficulty. Now remember, with insight and awareness about the difficulty, that in itself in many cases is not sufficient. Okay, we need to also act upon it. Sometimes people just realize they don't have been doing this. If I stop doing this, my problem will be resolved. So for example, if I stop yelling back, maybe the whole fight that we keep having will go. But if I don't stop yelling back in spite of realizing, doesn't work. Okay? There are different things. Like one is visualization. Many people swear by it. Visualization is thinking of the whole positive image of how your life will be when there is no difficulty of this sort. Okay? Seeking professional help if required, because many a times just the insight and the knowledge that I want to do something about it is not sufficient, and you genuinely try and you can't act upon the insights. So when you try from your side and you cannot act upon the insights, so I realize that, you know, no matter what, I cannot stop myself from doing this, is when you seek professional help. People even use certain self-help tools and self-help methods. So you can try that first and then seek professional help if required. But try doing something and then seeking professional help if required. Feel free to go to a professional. Or at least call up and check as to what you can do. We are just going to discuss certain tools and processes. So this is suggestions or affirmations. Affirmations are like, you can say auto-suggestions, you say it to yourself. Ideally, you craft them for yourself as per your requirement. Okay? There are ready suggestions and ready statements people get online for different kinds of problems. If they work for you, please listen to them. But ideally, it should be a customized kind of an approach. Okay? Something which will suit you completely and something which is completely in sync with your goal. Some online factors will also teach you how to make suggestions and affirmations. So you can refer to that first and then maybe pick another one and make it accordingly. Some people like to write them. Some people just read them. I would personally say write it, because you're conditioning your mind. You're actually doing it, that I am doing this, or I am happy, or I am confident, or whatever it is. Even with meditation or deep relaxation or hypnosis, people use suggestions. All right, for themselves, for empowering themselves. All right? There is something called as the if-then statement. Now, if-then statement is something which is a very powerful mechanism and is a strong part of sports psychology field. Okay? This is not done in a hypnotic state like the suggestions or a deep relaxed state. It can just be done like that, casually. Okay? Many sports persons and all will have their slogans and they'll have their suggestions, and you'll notice they're just saying something and walking to the field and all. You know, just zoom in next time when you're watching some sports channel, you'll be like, are they talking, they're cursing, they're swearing, what are they doing? But they are using some sort of power statements that they may have created for themselves. So if then statement, if represents the problem and then represents the solution to that problem. If could be a person, could be a situation, could be an emotion, and then is the solution to it. So taking a sports psychology example, let's say a batsman says that when I see a tall bowler, I feel very nervous. What can we change over here? The feeling that we can change. We can't tell the baller, na, thoda height kam karke aao. That's not possible. It's not in our hand that I'll only play against short ballers. Feeling of nervousness is something that a person can handle because it's within them. Okay? So if not nervous, how would you like to feel? I would like to feel confident. What makes you feel confident? Then I think of that particular century that I had scored. I feel very confident. So the statement will be something like, if I see a tall bowler, then I think of that century. So what has happened over here? We have borrowed confidence from some other place. Okay? So it need not even be related. So if the solution is strong enough, it can be borrowed from somewhere and the problem can be linked. So the problem and solution are linked and the person is supposed to keep repeating. Something like, if I see my boss, I feel angry. Now, we can't do anything about the boss. What would you like to do? You know, I want to feel calm, and when I take 3 deep breaths, I feel very calm. So you keep repeating, keep repeating, keep repeating. So it should be so automatic that the moment you see the boss, automatically 3 deep breaths should come to you. Alright? So we are constantly creating a repetition. If X happens, then Y happens. X, Y, X, Y, X, Y. We are creating a strong association, and by that we are generating a neuropathway. Neuropathways are, you can say, like highways in our mind, which bring us from one place to another. They send transport information and make us and act in a particular manner. So we are creating that habit pattern, you can say, by linking the problem to the solution. And it should be so strong that even in the middle of the night, somebody says, if you see a tall bowler, then I think of my century. And you should actually be able to think of that century. So keep repeating it. You can create an if-then statement like that, but it needs to be very, very specific in nature. Specific goal, specific outcome from which you are getting the solution. Alright, that's an if-then statement. Okay. In fact, to give you a better example of if-then, not if-then per se, but the strong association, irrespective of the religion we follow, the moment somebody says Hare Rama, the thought is Hare Krishna. Irrespective of your religion, because it's been repeated so many times. Right, so many such things are very instinctive like that. That's the exact thing we are trying to generate. That is the if-then. And then questions, which is our last topic for the day. Mind does not like incomplete information. So when somebody is trying to say something and they happen to stop in between, don't we try to complete their sentence? We do. How many of us have tried that? We have, right? Or if nothing, not directly, at least in our mind we'll complete our statement, their statement. Because mind doesn't like incomplete information. That is one phenomenon. Second, somebody just asks you a name of a movie or a person and you may not remember it right now. But later, somewhere while doing something else in the day, this was the name. Suddenly, yaad aa gaya. So, technically, that search engine was on till then. And it then went and it figured the information out. Okay? So, that is what questions do. We ask questions to ourselves anyway. Why does this happen to me? Why do I always do this? Mujhe kyun sari problems aati hain? All these questions. The answers you get are very crazy. Because you're stupid, you're old, you're fat, you're young, you're small, you're tiny, etc., etc. Which are not productive in nature. Instead, we ask productive questions, make our search engines look for productive answers in order to be able to get good outcome. So instead of saying, yaar, mera hi sale kyun nahi hota hai products ka, if I ask myself, what can I do to improve my sales? Or what can I do to meet the right people for selling better products or good products? That way, the search engine will be directed towards the right things. It's like Google engine. Google pe type karke dekho, reasons of relationship failure. The reasons you'll get will be phenomenal. You instead type ways to improve relationships. The answers you'll get will be different accordingly. That's exactly what you do with the mind. It will act like a search engine. So some answers you may get immediately. Some answers will come out like the name of the movie and the person eventually later. So if you have a goal, ask a question like that, which is productive. So four steps for it would be, become aware of the questions you're asking yourself. Evaluate this question. Is it a good question? Is it productive enough? Choose a better question if required, and whatever insights you get, please act on the insights. So if I realize that I have this particular friend who can help me, the friend didn't take birth today, the friend was already there. I just realized that she can help me. So it's better I call by acting on whatever insight I have got. So these are some of the self-help tools which you can try for yourself. Alright? And please remember, if talking to someone or any kind of vent out procedures or any kind of self-help tools don't help and don't provide you enough relief, please seek professional help. You are not weak or you are not a loser or a failure if you seek any professional help from anywhere. Please do that. Pick up the phone, ask people and go seek professional help if required. Okay? So that's it. We're done for the day. Thank you so much.